Welcome to this ninth podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to strategies for the intervention and treatment of addiction. We will talk about the importance of treating all aspects of the individual, the chronic disease management model and why it has many principles that are applicable for effective addiction interventions, describe the design and characteristics of a successful physician health program, and look at how PHPs share many conceptual and operational practices with the chronic disease management model. To revisit the definition provided in the introductory podcast in this series, the American Society of Addiction Medicine defines addiction as a primary chronic disease of brain reward, motivation, memory, and related circuitry. Dysfunction in these circuits leads to characteristic biological, psychological, social, and spiritual manifestations. The disease has devastating implications, including personal consequences for the user and societal consequences that constrain the existing healthcare system. So designing effective treatment strategies is critical for both the affected individual as well as society at large. But how does one treat the individual? What aspects of their mental, emotional, and physical personality need to be addressed? Dr. Michael Kaufman is the Medical Director of the Physician Health Program at the Ontario Medical Association. Here he describes how a holistic approach to addiction treatment addresses the four levels of the individual: biological, psychological, social, and spiritual.
I'm talking about the holistic understanding, the comprehensive understanding of our patients, their illness, and their recoveries. I'm talking about getting well physically, which is where we often is our jumping off place, and detox and getting physical health back. I'm talking about our psychological health, our thinking, our problem solving, our judgment, our memory. I'm talking about our social health, our relationships with our friends, family, colleagues, loved ones. And as Diane has mentioned, our spiritual health, and that's the really cool part in working in this field, because there aren't very many other areas, in at least in medicine anyway, where we talk about spirituality very much. And I'm not talking about religious practice here. I'm talking about philosophical questions, existential questions. I'm talking about where we fit in a world with our friends, family, colleagues, co-workers, and others. I'm talking about our thinking about big questions, and why are we here, and what is, where do I fit, and is, what is a power greater than me, and what does that mean in my life, and how do I have a relationship with such an idea? Addiction, for those of you, and I know that there will be some of you who have experienced in the room who have experienced it, certainly there will be some of you who have observed a loved one go through an addictive disease and process. You know how soul destroying it is. You know how isolating it is. Recovery from addiction is the opposite. It's the reestablishment of connectedness and coming out of isolation and joining. So when we use a complete or a comprehensive medical model approach, all of these domains are addressed all of the time.
So treating all parts of the individual is a key component in affecting change and recovery in the addicted individual. But what treatment models can be most effectively and efficiently conveyed to the population at large? Well, many researchers feel the chronic disease management model is the perfect solution for effective addiction interventions. Implementation of the chronic disease management model for conditions like diabetes, hypertension, and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease has helped reduce wait times for services, reduce healthcare resource utilization, and most importantly, improve overall patient health. Dr. Richard Luanchuk is the Chief of Chronic Disease Management for Alberta Health Services. Here he describes the need for a shift from episodic care towards a CDM model.
Sort of stating the obvious, and we've heard this before, is the way in which we practice and deliver healthcare really is no longer tenable. And the way in which we've practiced healthcare or delivered healthcare for years has been, we'll wait until you get sick, and once you get sick, though, we're going to try and have the best healthcare system. And because we've been really, really cursed in Alberta with lots of money, we can even spend more money. So, we'll wait until you get sick, and we'll wait until you get really sick. But boy, when you get into end-stage heart failure, we're going to have the best heart transplant system in the world for you. So that don't work no more. And actually, if you look at the incremental benefit of high technology, the more you spend on healthcare in a state or in a province or in a country, actually the worse the outcomes. So by implication, I guess if you spend nothing, you have the best outcomes. But the reason being is that when we spend a lot of money, we spend it at the end stage of disease, high technology, and what we now recognize is that spending it at the front end of care, in primary care, prevention, keeping people healthy, actually is the most cost-effective method. So in other words, better to change the oil in your car than to wait until the engine blows and replace the engine. And I guess I was a little bit of the, when I alluded to the, a little bit of the challenge of trying to deal with diabetes in that province in China, their attitude was, well, each hospital has a diabetes clinic staffed with specialists, and when you talk to the specialists there, same, absolutely the same as in North America. We're overworked. There's not enough of us. We need more diabetologists. We need more endocrinologists. Ask them a question, well, you have these fancy diabetes clinics. How do people actually know that they have diabetes to get there? And they looked at me dumbfounded, and I'm still waiting for that answer. So the question is, do we set up a whole bunch of treatment programs, or do we actually work upstream? You know, what is our ratio of prevention programs and prevention versus treatment?
So addiction treatment is evaluated under an acute care model, as though there were a cure for the disease. Patient outcomes are assessed at various points after discharge from a discrete episode of treatment. However, clinical neuroscience research indicates that addiction is a chronic, relapsing brain disease. By definition, a chronic disease is never cured and does not simply go away after treatment. Rather, it requires continuous management over the lifetime of the individual and appropriate treatment during active phases. Dr. Thomas McClellan is the director of the Center on Substance Abuse Solutions at the University of Pennsylvania. He advocates for a chronic disease management model for addiction treatment, citing the success of physician health programs.
Unlike any other area of medicine, you got to be either an airline pilot or a doctor to get really effective care in the addiction field. You don't have to be a doctor or an airline pilot to get effective diabetes, hypertension, asthma, chronic pain, chronic sleep treatment. Okay? Bob DuPont and Greg Skipper, we looked at physician health plans in the United States in a lot of different states, and they do treatment very differently than treatment that you would get if your kid or your wife or loved one goes to treatment, at least in the United States. There, an individual with substance use problem is identified usually by a colleague and offered a choice. And the choice is come in, sign a contract, agree to this, to enter the physician health plan for usually five years, or we will go forward to prosecute you on the whatever infraction led to your identification as a substance user. The stages of treatment, really formal treatment, is about a year, includes roughly something like 60 to 90 days of residential care and another 6 to 9 months of aftercare. Most physicians are able to go into practice after the residential phase, but monitoring and supports, very importantly, it's not just monitoring. They engage the family. Family is critical in the treatment of addicted physicians and airline pilots and lawyers. They bring the families in. They engage them. These physicians had to go to AA. They had to go to the abstinence be part of the Abstinence Society, the Caduceus Society. They got worksite monitoring visits. Another doctor in the program would show up at the place, say, hey, let's go have a cup of coffee, and by the way, fill this cup. And that would occur at various times. They had to go see personal therapists, and they were encouraged to get family therapists. And lots of urine drug screenings.
As mentioned, several published research studies have documented the success of physician health programs. A 5-year follow-up study of participants in the Ontario PHP found that 71% maintained complete abstinence with no relapse. 14% had long-term recovery with some relapse, and only 15% were lost or quit the program. Program evaluation data show significant improvements in overall life satisfaction and other key areas such as wellness, job effectiveness, and social relationships among participating physicians. So what are some of the key elements of the program that led to this remarkable success? Dr. Diane Meyer is the program and clinical director at the Alberta Medical Association. Here she and Dr. Kaufman describe the design and characteristics of a successful physician health program.
Our programs really do begin with prevention education. I think both of our programs do well over a session, an educational session per week or more, to students and residents and practicing physicians, usually where they're at, to deliver the messages of physician health, addiction, but beyond, because we're understanding it as more of an occupational, cultural endeavor as well. We always want to ensure that those physicians get early access to services, whether that might be in their community at first, but then we have that tertiary level, which we know that they actually need treatment, residential treatment primarily, to begin with, case management and the monitoring piece. So that's our tertiary level, which would be keeping with Richard's thoughts.
We then monitor this whole thing in a long-term, go-forward case-managed environment. We do it contractually. We do, as you heard Diane say, we do use biological monitoring. We have face-to-face interviews with our own monitors based in the community and based in my office. We reintegrate into the workplace and have monitors there. We have communication with family. We cover that whole biopsychosocial spectrum, gather in the data, my case managers do, and from that we can put together the whole picture. There are contingencies for non-compliance. There are times when we may have to report out. Happily, we rarely have to do that. I'm not going to dwell on this other than to tell you, yes, it is a case management approach. Yes, it's the very top of Richard's pyramid. And it is intensive, and especially in our complicated cases at the beginning. And as the years go by, it gets less and less and easier and easier.
In effect, PHPs share many conceptual and operational practices with the chronic disease management model. Both have a long-term approach and focus on case management, assessment, monitoring, and multidisciplinary care. Although not all PHPs provide direct treatment services, these programs drive the treatment process with multiple service partners. PHP-led addiction treatment involves many components, including comprehensive assessments, detoxification, residential treatment, psychotherapy, pharmacotherapy, mutual support programs, treatment of comorbid disorders and other addictions, and family supports. Aftercare services continue for 1 to 2 years. Sustained recovery is actively managed through education, counseling, relapse prevention skills, healthy lifestyle and self-care practices, monitoring of abstinence, and periodic reassessment. Dr. Michael Kaufman outlines some of the elements of the chronic disease management model that are keys to the Ontario Physician Health Program.
Group support, mutual support, peer support. We have peers of recovering health professionals of different kinds in groups, professionally facilitated, all over the province of Ontario. All of our doctors attend these. Identification of the comorbid disorders, as you heard earlier, the risk of, in chronic disease management, the risks go up of relapse when there are multiple comorbidities, especially psychiatric ones, pain-related ones, and addictions, and so on. If we're not seeing those, if we're not attentive to them and the emergence of them and the treatment of them aggressively, our people are at risk. And if you think about drug treatment as being medical model, I think I've already disabused you of view of that notion. In fact, in our approach to the treatment of addictions, all too often, drugs aren't prescribed often enough, in my opinion. such things as naltrexone, antabuse, and so on are very useful for drug and alcohol problems and are seldom prescribed, in fact.
Engaging the patient and family support is critical in the road to recovery. Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he talks about how addicted physicians can take the first step towards recovery and how physician health programs are an important part of the recovery process.
We're not very good at diagnosing ourselves. I remember when I was doing psychiatry as an undergraduate, I got every single disorder in the DSM because I applied it. Oh, that's me. You know, so we're not very objective when it comes to trying to determine if we meet the criteria. So you probably need to find somebody that you trust enough and get an interview. Every single province has access to a physician's health program, physician support program.
Right.
So they can put you in touch with some, and it's confidential.
And many of the universities have one of those programs too, which is good.
Yeah, the nice thing is that it doesn't have to go back to a regulatory body or a disciplinary body. The earlier you do it, the less likely it mm-hmm. will get you into any kind of trouble at all. And the only way it's going to get you into trouble is if your behavior puts other people at risk.
Okay. Right.
So the sooner you get it checked out, the better. It's not a black mark. And besides, if you do have this disorder, pretending you don't doesn't make it better.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Addiction is a chronic, relapsing brain disease, and holistic treatment plans can be effective interventions since they address the needs of the complete individual. The chronic disease management model has many principles that are applicable for effective addiction interventions, including patient education, support programs, promotion of healthy lifestyles, and relapse prevention. A successful physician health program includes case monitoring, education, support, and family engagement. PHPs share many conceptual and operational practices with the chronic disease management model, including treating an entire population, reliance on primary care providers, and the focus on continuity of care. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. What elements of chronic disease management will you be able to apply in your program or practice when developing a management plan for a patient with addiction? 2. How do you think practicing physicians should support their patients in the long-term management and follow-up for the successful treatment of addiction? We hope that you have enjoyed this podcast on the prevention, intervention, and treatment of addiction. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.